We can fool each other. We will never fool the living God. He knows precisely what's in our hearts. And he also told us that what's in the heart will manifest through your words. And what we speak about the most, we find ourselves doing. And what we speak about the most, so do we become. The exact subject we speak about the most, you will become those things that are in abundance in your heart, spoken through the mouth. And if you continue to repeat them, you'll become exactly what you speak. The Bible says, as a man thinketh, so is he. Oh, so many weapons out there. So many. Now, we all know, despite our conversation right now, despite the heavy weights I carry, because, by the way, folks, listen, if I carry heavy weights because of what the Lord showed me, because of what's on my heart, all these things, and I'm able to do it, or I would not have them. God will never put anything upon you beyond that which you can bear. So everything you've ever gone through, you've been able to take. I recommend not complaining about anything happening in your life another day. Don't do that to yourselves. If you were not able to carry it, do you really think God would have put it on you? No, he would not. If you're not able to walk through it, do you really believe that God would have put that thing in front of you? No, he wouldn't. If you're not able to bear it, do you really think God would have covered you with it? No, he would not. So everything you're going through, every situation, every feeling, everything, you're able to overcome. You're able to go through. You have to remember that. There's no room for complaints in truth. In truth, there's no room for complaints. Complaints are nothing more than a rebellious act of what you do not like of the Father. And that is a terrible statement, but that's the way it is. Not to mention, complaining tempts the Lord our God. And there are very few things that tempt him. Complaining is one of them. When we murmur and complain, we tempt him. That is questioning the way he's raising you. That is questioning his perfect method. That is putting the way he operates into subjection. And sometimes we forget he is the creator. I know that people have told you that, I've told plenty of folks that Satan wrote the Bible, and I know why they believe this. I'm going to have a talk about that one night, by the way, and why people believe it in truth. You know, there's a book called The Devil's Bible, and it's full of philosophies. But do you know the other papers that go with the book of the individual and what he was really looking for, what actually came out? That's where they got the idea from. That was a seed sown back then, right? And it came through a monk. But it's worded in such a way that it can really grip the mind. It offers an explanation to a few things that seem to be true, and people end up believing that Satan wrote the Bible. No, he did not. Satan didn't write the Bible, because Satan would never rebuke himself. But certain things of that are wrong. One of the big key points of this has to do with your mind. Let me give you a hint. Many people believe that because of the mind in this way. They believe that the Bible is taking all of your thoughts, your personal thoughts and everything away from you and causing you to be autonomous or an automaton thinking like somebody else. That's not what the Bible does. In fact, they have it all backward. What did the Lord say about some of these deceiving things that would be upon the face of the earth in the end times? They would be strong. That's what he said. Strong delusions. God will give them a strong delusion that they would believe a lie, that they all might be damned who love not the truth but a pleasure in unrighteousness. See, you come to find out the only way that you can stay within some type of delusional state is if you have pleasure in unrighteousness. If you don't have pleasure in unrighteousness, there's no way in the world you're going to stay in any delusion, but that the Lord will bring you out of that. But the Lord is responsible. He's the one that's going to send that delusion, to hand them over to that delusion. God will be the one that does this so that they will never escape. Just to clarify that point, I know a lot of people think that they use the word, they say a deception is coming. No, it isn't, because God's people cannot be deceived. But those who don't love the truth are going to be handed over to a strong delusion, a delusion spoken about in the book of Jeremiah. That continued with Paul's writings. A delusional person thinks that what they believe is the truth, and you're not going to convince them any other way. So if somebody believes that what they're believing in is the facts, it is the truth, you can forget it. You just lost. At that point, God will hand them over to the lust of their flesh, to fulfill the lusts of their flesh, and guilt will add upon guilt, all because they did not love the word. There's so many times you can care about people so much, but if you hold them back, you're not loving them, you're restricting them. You may think you're doing the right thing, but in the scheme of things, you're only a few seconds old. You don't know too much. If you're 200 years old right now, you don't know too much. You're 2 seconds old. You don't know too much. If you're below the age of 200, you're 1 second old. You don't know too much. These people that are given over to a strong delusion, they didn't love the truth. Can you know all about the truth and not love it? Because if you say yes, you need to think of how. How could a person not love the truth yet they know everything about it? How many of you know about Saddam Hussein? You know a lot about Saddam Hussein. That doesn't mean you love the guy, does it? No. How many of you know about spiders? You know a lot about spiders. That does not mean you love them, does it? So yes, you can know a lot about a subject or a person or a thing and still not love it. But the Bible says they loved not the truth. They didn't love the truth. What happens when you love the truth? I'll tell you. If you love the truth, you'll love the source of that truth. And if that source become the truth that you truly love, because when you, if to love the truth is to love your Lord and Savior. And if you love your Lord and Savior, you're never going to turn him into your own personal character in life. You don't want him to be this way or that way. When you love someone in truth, you don't want to change them. When you love someone in truth, you want them to be exactly who they are. And because you love them for being exactly who they are, you also accept, and in the Lord's case, being perfect and our Savior. You know what that means? That means you love his way. Uh-oh, and this is where the problem is. So then, to love the way of Jesus, this is where the problem is. There's so many people who have a problem. They do not love the way of Jesus. What I mean is, right now, you can get 15 Christians together, and they'll have 15 interpretations of one scripture. All of them see it differently. My question is, how many will see it the way Jesus established it? See, a spoken truth needs no interpretation when it's understood as the truth. Truth does not need an interpretation when it is known as being the truth. Alterations come when we're trying to make that truth support something we have. See, if I were to take the Word of God and have it support something that I have or to defend me in a certain way, guess what I'll do? I'll interpret it so it will support my ideologies. That's what I'm like to interpret the Word of God. I need the Spirit or I don't know the Word of God at all. Because if God left me alone to interpret His Word by my human mind, it would be an instant fallacy. It'd be a mistake. The interpretation of the words of Christ are given by way of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is reserved to those who obey the Lord. So those who obey the Lord in what they do truly understand without their interpretation. If they truly understand that word and they do it, they obey the Lord, then the Lord gives them what? He gives them more understanding of His word. Because they're trusting in the first small portion He gave. But all too often, folks, we don't do this. When a person thinks a person has to pay for what they've done, the Father does not think that way. In fact, He sent His Son so that we would not have to pay for what we did. So He thinks the opposite of those individuals who believe that. And yes, you have people in this world that are going to test that in you all the way through. They're always going to be here on this earth. There are going to be people all around you all the time who are going to test every aspect of your faith. And they are allowed to do it. They exist for that reason. For all of those people who think that somebody should pay for what they did, they think it was that bad, they should pay for what they did, you better thank God that God does not think that way. Thank the Father that the Father does not think that way. He thinks the opposite. For all those who believe that somebody should pay for what they have done, your Father in heaven does not think that way. In fact, He sent His only begotten Son that we would not have to pay for what we have done. Thank you, Lord Jesus. See, that's His way. You see how different His way is from most folks' ways? And if you love the truth, then you naturally love His way in that. But I'm telling you now, if you don't forgive somebody else, you don't love His way. You don't love His truth. And in that scripture says, they were given over to a strong delusion that they would believe a lie, that they all might be damned who loved not the truth, but had pleasure in unrighteousness. How many people are looking for something? I just uncovered. I just took off a layer, didn't I? That was a layer of an onion. I just took off. This whole process is designed. It is designed that you become exactly what you truthfully are. It is designed that the truth of you come right to the surface. Your flesh will be discarded. Your circumstances done away with. All of what you went through will be wiped away clean. You're going to stand by yourself with all the pain taken away, all the bad memories, all everything. Who you really are is going to surface. Some of you have to go through harsh, harsh things, but you don't even know why, do you? That's part of your breaking. See, when you don't love the flesh anymore, when you find out that the flesh is truly just a vehicle for this experience, and your flesh has been broken, it forces you to begin to accept God's word in a very different way, because you can't be like everybody else and still be totally intact by the flesh, halfway believing the word and halfway walking by flesh. Nope, you can't do that. You're going to have to break free totally from the flesh, just like Jesus wants all of us to break from the flesh and to walk spiritually. So he broke some of you early, give you a head start, letting you know about this experience from the beginning, not allowing you to return to the flesh, because once he allows your flesh to be broken, you can't return back to your flesh like you're innocent. Thus, you cannot excel by way of the flesh. You can only excel by way of the spirit. He did that out of love. He put a mark on you is what he did. Breaking your flesh early has ruined your chances of becoming 100% you in the flesh. Now you can only become 100% you in the spirit. Your flesh is ruined. Your flesh has no innocence to it, no anything to it. It is broken. It is ruined. It is scarred. It is tainted. So guess what? Get rid of it. You can only become 100% you in the spirit. Now he gave you a jump start. You didn't even know it. But he also did something else. Something that no one can really explain to you. It's going to have to be experienced. Because every time something goes against you in this world, you see what goes against you. Every time you have an experience and you're broken in the flesh in this world, you grow spiritually. You see, a day is coming when all of what man thought did not exist will stand right before their faces while they're still here on this earth. Men will confront things that have only been part of their nightmares. And all those who have already been cut away from the flesh have been developing things spiritually. They're not in the mindset of those in the flesh, spoiled in the flesh, living it up in the flesh. They're perfect in the flesh. All they know is the flesh. So that when a spiritual ancient thing stands before them and causes their flesh to freeze and their flesh to age, they'll have no power over what stands before them. But because certain individuals' flesh has been broken, they couldn't go back into the world to build up these flesh things. They heard the call of the Lord. They started to pick up spiritual things. You think it's a problem now, it'll become your blessing in the days to come. Many of us were broken. Many things seem unfair. If you open your eyes to the truth of the Lord, I won't have to tell you, and nobody else will have to tell you. The Lord will tell you exactly why he did what he did. He doesn't hide it. It's part of the process. That means you have a strong call on your life also, a personal responsibility. Whoever it is, why do you think you look at people and somehow you can know their circumstances? You can see if a person's oppressed. Why do you think you can do that? Why is it that you hear differently than everybody else around you? Why is it that you get excited from time to time because you perceived something nobody else could perceive? And truthfully, you have noticed that you have some type of spiritual gifting. You just don't talk about it. Why do you think that is? The Lord has armed you for something you had no idea you would have to face. And he's building you so you will never be lost. You see, because all those who never became spirit in this earth, they're going to die in their flesh. All those who become one with their flesh will die with the flesh. All those who become one with the spirit will have everlasting life, as the spirit also has everlasting life. Whatever you become one with is where your eternity is going to be spent with. If it's with the flesh must be discarded. It'll go back to where it came from, and the spirit will go back to where it came from. Darkness and light. God ruined your chances of becoming one with darkness. You know how people become one with darkness? They do that by way of the flesh. It's by what their flesh desires. That's how they become one with darkness. Well, the Lord ruined your flesh prematurely. You can't invest a lot in the flesh. You have no confidence in it. And so guess what you do? You start looking towards spiritual things. And that becomes your new home. Those things of the spirit become your new home. What you may not know is that there are a lot of folks just like you who have made God's word their home. You have lots of company. You just don't know it yet. I mean real company. Lots of brothers and sisters who share similar things with you. They too have been broken. In fact, the Lord has already told us before we depart this earth, we too must be broken. Some will be broken in the beginning, some will be broken in the end, but all of us will be broken. Not one of us is going to leave until we're broken. We can have that early, we can have that late. Some of you were broken early, some will be broken late, but at least you'll be broken. Because once you're broken of the flesh, you can live by way of the spirit. You cannot live by way of the spirit becoming one nor being one with the flesh. You can't do that. You'll die for sure. Imagine if you didn't go through what you went through with. You already know what you're preconditioned to do. You know that you would have been in the world because you would have excelled in certain areas. You see, your brokenness has stopped you from doing things in this world, hadn't it? Tell the truth to yourself, not to anybody else, to yourself. It's because your flesh was broken, you can only go so far in the world. And you could not complete it because your flesh was broken. There was something in you. It was almost like you tried to hide your brokenness. But that brokenness is what kept you from excelling in the world. God did not want to lose you. That you become part of the world and you be lost to him forever. No. You're his child. He'd break everything so that you can live. It's not an act of cruelty. It's a gift of love. But our interpretation from this point is to see it from the bottom up. One day, we'll see all the truth of all of it. The Lord was not willing to lose you to anything. I knew a person who, this person was beautiful, but they had an accident by a drunk driver. For years, they blamed this drunk driver. I mean, they had pretty bad scars in the face. This person observed, as of late, many of the actresses and the actors out there. And because of this person's job, they know exactly what they are, and it kind of stunned them to know how they are outside of the cameras and everything else, how some of them are totally lost and bound by things that are just seem like they come from fairy tales. At that point, this individual became thankful for every single scar that kept this person out of the world. There are individuals who they got angry at the Lord because they didn't make it playing instruments for big bands and being in movies for this, that, and the other. They became a little angry. Had you been successful at what you attempted to create in the world, if the Lord would have had you become successful in that, you would have been lost to the Lord because all of your ideologies would have been bound with money, with riches, with things. Your spirit would have been weak. You would have been totally turned over to the world. You would have excelled in the world, but have been lost to the Lord. But the Lord did not want to lose any of us. He wanted us to live. What did it take to get you to come to Christ anyway? Think about that. What, you know, I look at my own life. What in the world did it, what did it take to get me to go to the Lord? I mean, totally go to the Lord. Do you know what it took? Do you know what that took? Nobody could have done that save the Lord. If anything was breakable in me, the Lord had to break it. He had to break everything. Because one thing broken on me, and if I have an alternative, I'm going to use that. The Lord knew I was resourceful. So he had to break everything. Everything. And after he broke it, it felt like the world ended. But when the whole world felt like, when it seemed like the whole world was lost, it ended and all my goals and future dreams and everything else was gone, he called me unto himself. That's when I found life. What did it take for the Lord to get you to go to Jesus?